So hello everyone, I'm Anuj, I'm from India. So I'll be talking about forecasting and observing airfare trends using Python and neural networks. So just a quick question, like how many of you have heard that the earlier you book a flight ticket, the cheaper? So I think most of you might have heard. So I'm here to bust that tiny little bubble saying that that's not. It's a very common misconception that the earlier you book a flight, the cheaper. So does airfare actually have a minimum? Let's say I'm going to book a flight 90 days from now. So is it the right time to book, or do you think you should wait? You're never sure, right? So just let us look. So yeah, it is assumed that the earlier you book, the cheaper. But this is one typical example of a fare of a price. So if you can see, from 60 to 90 days before departure, the price is actually higher than the actual minimum. Right, so this is a trend of one particular airline. It's very difficult to generalize the fare trend, saying that, okay, I'm going to just see a pattern where I can find this. This is one particular case, but I'm just giving you an example where it is not, it doesn't follow the common rule that the earlier you book, the cheaper. So, and also before that, the analysis and the data I've collected was unfortunately of Indian Airlines. So I think you'll see a few names which are Indian Airlines. So yeah, you can probably just ignore that. So why does the fare change, and how does it matter? So basically, every airline, let's say, has 100 seats. They try to optimize their revenue from that particular flight. So what they do, they have different fare classes, or RBD, which is called reservation booking designator. So they have, let's say, 10 tickets for A, 20 tickets for B, 30 tickets for C, and so on. So every fare class has a different airfare, and it is varied based on the demand. So for example, on weekends, the fare classes are changed very frequently because the demand is high. Or during weekdays, it's low. So what happens is, let's say, the 5 tickets in the first or the lowest fare class are sold out very quickly. So it quickly changes to the next fare class. So for example, so these are different fare classes, and you can see throughout the fare classes, the fare is never same. It's either increasing or decreasing. So it sometimes starts off with the lowest fare class, but that's not guaranteed. So there are a few observations which I haven't added in the presentation. For example, a few airlines have a constant starting rate. For example, like if the flight is introduced 120 days in advance, they have the minimum fare, and that is a general rule. But for some airlines, they have different fares. For example, if a flight is going from Madrid to Barcelona, one airline, what they try to do is they vary their fare from the beginning itself. For example, they have $100, $200, and $300, and all the three flights change, the prices change as per the demand. And a few airlines, they have a $100 constant, and the fare keeps increasing or decreasing. So it depends on the airline sometimes. But this is a general rule. Like, for every airline has an RBD, and the fare varies across RBD. But you may wonder, okay, is this always the case, or how often does this happen that, you know, I booked a fare and it goes down? So the answer is less. I mean, so if you can see, these are 6 Indian airlines, and the probability that there is a minimum fare coming up. So if you can see, one airline, Air India, has only 25% probability that the fare might go down. So if I'm looking at a flight 90 days from now, only in 10 or 15 days I can find a fare which is less than the fare now, the current fare. But in a few airlines like Vistara, it is about 60%. That means you should probably wait longer before you book a flight in that airline. So again, it varies according to the airline. So the most important part of my analysis was not the modeling part, because building a model is a second part, and the airline data, there is not much public information available. For example, like if you're looking at a booking site, like say Skyscanner, what do you see? You see the price, you see the weekday of the departure, and the days to departure. These are the only three features available to the public, right? So we cannot use more data or data apart from that to make any predictions. So we should try and model our data in such a way that we are able to overcome that. So I've made a few visualizations which help me add more features to the data. For example, So average waiting time. So it always happens with me that, okay, I have a journey coming up in 80 to 90 days, and I have, let's say, $100. The fare is $100. So now I always wonder, okay, how many days do you think I can wait till the price increases? Right. So let's say I tell you that you can wait at least for 4 to 5 days before the price goes down, which means you have 4 to 5 days to think before you book the flight. Right. So let's see how that varies. So these are again a few airlines. So let's say for Indigo, for 1 to 20 days before departure, the average waiting time is 1.8, approximately 2 days. So which means if there is a flight coming up in 20 days, you can wait for an average of 2 days before the price changes. And if you can see, it's the highest for 21 to 40 days in most of the cases. Right, and again, it varies according to the airline, because lots of things again depend on the airline, because it depends on the traffic at that particular airport, the number of flights the airline is operating, because one flight can have a lot of flights operating between two destinations. For example, in India, Indigo is the most popular or has the highest number of flights operating between two popular destinations, whereas Vistara or Air India have a less number of flights compared to Indigo. So that these are other features we can add into the model, but that is only when you have a lot of cities. For example, you're looking at 150 cities, then you can add a feature saying that, okay, what is the traffic of this particular airline at this airport? Or what is the traffic, or what is the percentage of flights operating between these two destinations? That is when it is going to matter. But if you're only doing your analysis for 3 or 4 cities, it wouldn't really matter. That's what I've observed. So the next one is weekday versus price. So this is the weekday of journey. So it is kind of obvious that the price goes up during the weekends, but during the weekdays, Tuesday and Wednesday are like the optimal days for you to travel, right? So that is why I'm not flying back on Sunday after the conference is over. I'm flying back on Wednesday so that my price is cheaper from here to India. So yeah, and there is another observation which I made. This is the weekday of journey. So there is another component, the day when you're booking the flight. So should you book a flight on Saturday compared to Friday or Tuesday? So what do you think? Which would be the cheapest? Booking it on a Friday or booking it on a Saturday or booking it on a Tuesday? So I think it was about Wednesday to Thursday was the best day you can book your flight, whereas Friday and Saturday were the most expensive days to book a flight, not to travel, to book a flight. Right? So weekday also plays a crucial role, and that was one of the features in my model. So the weekday of departure and the weekday when you're booking the ticket. So these were two features which I added after looking at these numbers. So these were a few observations, and apart from that, there was one other observation I made which I couldn't add here, which is the time slot of journey. Let's say it's morning, evening, night, midnight, late night, or afternoon. So this also matters a lot, because early morning and evening flights tend to be costlier. That is obvious again, compared to flights in the afternoon or late night. So this is an observation which is generic across the airline. So there are a few observations which vary over airline, the type of airline or the airline which we're using, and a few which do not vary over the choice of airline. So that was one feature which was common, and we can directly put it into the model. So now I'll talk something about the data preparation and the data cleaning. So as you can see, the data we had was just the price of the flight, then the number of days to departure and weekday. These were derived. But how do I even prepare it to feed it into a model? So there are two ways. You use a regression, which means you try to predict the price of a particular day. Right? So let's say if I'm looking at Skyscanner now, and I have a flight from Madrid to Barcelona, which is $100. So I can build a model which predicts the price of the flight 60 days down the line or 90 days down the line. Or I predict true or false, a yes or no. Like, should you book a flight today or not? It's a binary, it's a classification, right? So you can, the objective is what shapes your data preparation. So if you just want a yes or no for today, like if I'm looking at Skyscanner, should I book a flight or not? Yes or no, that's it. So that is not very useful, because what might happen is that it says no because there is a $1 decrease in price predicted. So the second case would be more useful, where you can see the prices every day, right? So let's say you see that, okay, I'm only going to make $10, which is not a big deal for me. Let me book the flight. Or let's say I'm going to save $50 on a $100 flight. That is going to be significant, right? So the second case is obviously more helpful, but it is also very difficult to train. Because, so the data I collected was only for 13 cities, because I collected the data myself on a local computer. The data which I collected every day, so I built a scraper which ran itself every day. So it took about 4 to 5 hours for the scraper to run. And it used to collect data on these 13 cities for 90 days in advance. So for every day, I look at the prices 90 days from now for 13 cities, all the combinations. So it's 13C2. So that's about a million rows every day. Storing that data was also a problem again, because when I started my presentation, I thought it would be a few thousand rows or a million rows at max, but it turned out to be about 150 million rows, which I didn't see that coming. So I only had to restrict my analysis for 7 days, which was also difficult to do, like generating the graphs and everything. So yeah, I mean, building that scraper was very difficult, and I'll talk about it once, like a few challenges I faced. So libraries I've used, I didn't even use Beautiful Soup and everything. I just had to use a request library to pull in the web page, parse the API, parse the JSON, and just dump the JSON in a Mongo database. Stacks and queues for efficient URL handling. So there were about 15,000 URLs, each containing about 100 flights, which I had to scrape. So I had to process them very properly, right? Because, so let's say if a scraper is running for 4 to 5 hours, there might be a possibility that your laptop goes off. So it was my laptop, so that is how I built it. And it was on a very small scale. So there might be a power outage, there might be an internet outage, there might be an exception, the server might reject your request. So all these were handled by the code, which means the code runs independently without any human intervention. That's because I wouldn't have time to sit with it for 4 to 5 hours. I built it in such a way that it doesn't need human intervention at all. And it was on a small scale. So it wasn't scraping millions and billions of rows. It was only scraping about 15 to 20,000 URLs every day. But still, I used simple stacks and queues to push in only 50 requests every minute so that the website doesn't reject my request, and the handling is minimal. But I still have measures to take care of 403 errors, which is this website refusing a response. And let's say the website in fact does reject your response, the code waits for, let's say, 60 seconds to 120 seconds, depending on the speed with which it was scraping till now. And then it waits accordingly and then gets back to work again. So on an average, it takes about 4 to 5 hours for the scraper to run. I also used multiprocessing, which is a simple library called multiprocessing in Python, which speeds up the process up to five times, depending on the number of cores. So if I would have used or executed the scraper on a server, I could have used more threads, like because it has more number of cores. My laptop only had like 5 to 8 cores, so I could only use 5 to 8 parallel processes. Then cron jobs. So for those who don't know what cron jobs are, it is a very simple scheduling thing which any computer gives you, where you can schedule a tasks for every like n seconds or every n minutes, every n days, every n months. So I used to use these things for doing things like downloading my TV series every week, or executing a code every day, or something like that in university, and it turned out to be very, very helpful here. So a cron job makes sure that your scraper runs every day without you actually having to sit down and run it. So every day at 1 a.m., the scraper starts itself, runs till the morning, and then closes itself. So you can obviously add error logs and stuff so that you can just go through it once you get up. So this was how you can automate. And you can do things like this cron jobs are very, very handy for everything you do, because it's just scheduling, right? You don't have to worry about it running or it executing or stuff like that, but you have to test it very carefully before you run cron jobs. Then, up to 4 to 5 hours of execution time. And I did not use things like multiple proxies or fake IP addresses. So, or multiple IP addresses. So what happens there is that you try to imitate, like the code tries to imitate to the server, it imitates multiple servers. Like it uses 10 to 15 IP addresses to keep rotating different IP addresses so that the website doesn't block you, right? So that is how usually, like let's say people who scrape billions of pages every day use. So they use fake user agents, fake IP addresses, or different proxies to make sure the website doesn't block them. But I have not used that because you have to pay for that. So yes. Now you might be wondering what the results are for a model train. So the model train here is a classification one, not a regression one, because I did not have the computing power to actually build the model, store the data, and run the build the model. So this is just a classification model, which means that it just gives you a yes or no depending on the day. So it has features like the days to departure, obviously, the price today, then the weekday of the departure, the weekday today, and things like that. And this is probably the simplest model you can build. This is a simple ANN. So it's about 5 to 6 lines of code where it's using TensorFlow. There is a wrapper called TFLearn, which I've used, and the layer is a very simple 432, 1682. So there are 3 hidden layers there. Trust me, I don't know a lot of neural networks and deep learning, but this is the basic model I've built. I've been working more on the data preparation and data cleaning because I thought that was more important when you're building a model of this size. And the accuracy was 73%, which is not bad. I've read research papers who have tested logistic regression and all the traditional methods of regression, and the accuracy comes out to be almost the same. Like they have 75% to 73%, but the precision and recall matter a lot, right? So the precision, which is the true positives by total number of positives, is 83%, and the recall is 83% again. But here you have to understand that out of 1,000 cases, there are only a few hundred cases where you can actually save money. So it is very difficult for a model to identify those, right? So I'm trying to build, better models. Like I know that RNNs work very good or better with time series data compared to a simple neural network, but that is going to again take a lot of computation power. So that is probably the next phase of this project, where I'll be building better models on data and again using more data, let's say, and features like the traffic at the airport, which depends again on the number of cities you are using. So yeah, I think that is it from my side. So I'll be happy to answer any questions if you have.